Hello, and welcome to Nursing Experts Translating the Evidence module about evidence-based public health nursing practice. In this module, we will be examining the role of evidence-based public health nursing. Evidence-based practice is an important process to use when making decisions in today's healthcare environment.
In this module, we will learn about evidence-based public health nursing, the significance of evidence-based practice, and we will apply these concepts by reviewing a case study.
Implementation of evidence-based practice guidelines has been shown to improve nursing practice and client outcomes, as well as reduce cost and standardized care. An evidence-based approach to public health could potentially have numerous direct and indirect benefits, including access to more and higher quality information on best practice, a higher likelihood of successful prevention programs and policies, greater workforce productivity, and more efficient use of public and private resources. There is now an overwhelming amount of new information generated annually, monthly, and even weekly. Health professionals cannot be expected to keep current by reading everything that is published. Instead, the evidence-based practice process teaches professionals how to find the information that they need and when they need it. The Public Health Accreditation Board is the organization that oversees the accreditation of public health departments. It lists evidence-based practices as one of their standards. In this example, standards are the required level of achievement that a health department is expected to meet. It is interesting to note that one of the expectations is that health departments are to identify and use the best available evidence for making informed public health practice decisions. In addition, another standard is to promote understanding and use of the current body of research, its results, evaluation, and evidence-based practices with appropriate audiences. Evidence-based practice helps us answer questions to our nursing practice, such as how do we know we are doing the right thing? And especially in these difficult times, evidence-based practice helps us to make those tough decisions and give us the confidence to make the right choice. Evidence-based public health nursing practice looks at research and also takes into consideration the following questions, such as what has been done? How did it work? And how can I use that information to help my client or population? Bronson describes evidence as the available body of facts or information indicating whether a belief or proposition is true or valid. Bronson continues to state that evidence is limited for many public health interventions, yet approaches should be based on the best possible science, be multidisciplinary, and center on sound planning and evaluation methods. Evidence-based public health nursing is the process of developing, implementing, and evaluating proven programs or policies to positively impact the health of a defined population. There are several key components of evidence-based public health practice. One component is making decisions using the best available peer-reviewed evidence or searching the literature. Another key component is using data and information systems in a systematic method, applying programming and planning frameworks, engaging the community in assessment and decision-making, which is also known as community-based participatory research. Another component is conducting a sound evaluation. And then the last key component is to disseminate the information about what you learned to key stakeholders and decision makers. Here is a flowchart that displays the bringing together of the professional skills, knowledge, and instinct with the knowledge of client preferences, such as their values and beliefs, to determine the best evidence for us to make a professional decision. As a public health nurse and other public health disciplines, you have the professional skills, knowledge, and that gut instinct to do what is best for that population that you work with on a daily basis. It is also important to consider the client preferences, because an intervention that may be acceptable in a liberal environment may be rejected in a conservative environment. One example would be the practice of handing out condoms in a high school setting. There are many advantages to using evidence-based public health nursing. Some of those include a higher likelihood of success when decisions are based on evidence rather than historical, political, or other pressures. By using evidence-based practice, common indicators can be identified and used to evaluate your own project. New knowledge can be generated, existing programs can be supported, and even expanded, and evidence can be used to advocate for new programs. In summary, the advantages of applying evidence-based public health nursing practice results in more effective programming, better policies, improved decision-making, a better chance at funding and also sustaining that funding, and maintaining that program. This is an image from Satterfield that represents how decisions are made in planning programs, developing interventions, and evaluating program outcomes. If you notice, the circle in the middle is the decision that we make as a public health nurse or as a committee. The top circle, which is the best available research evidence, represents the information that you find while conducting a literature review, or it's also your peer-reviewed literature. The bottom left circle, which is population characteristics, needs, values, and preferences, represents the values of the population. For example, an intervention that may have worked in an urban setting may not be appropriate for a rural setting. And the bottom right circle, resources including practitioner expertise, I refer to this as your gut instinct. Barriers to implementing evidence-based public health nursing includes your political environment. An Institute of Medicine article described that decision-making in public health is often driven by crises, hot issues, and concerns for organized interest groups. I think we can all find examples of this when assessing the COVID-19 pandemic and how each public health department and state department chose to respond to the pandemic. There are other barriers to implementing evidence-based public health, such as a lack of relevant and timely research, a lack of knowledge may cause you to make an uneducated decision, a deficit in information systems, resources, leadership, and competencies can all interfere with that successful implementation of evidence-based practice. Finally, here is the graphic from Bronson's model that displays the complete 7-stage process of evidence-based public health. If we notice, at number 1 is the community assessment. This is where you will gather information about your population. A community assessment may be targeted to a specific or general population. In addition to your community assessment, you want to identify the setting and the issue. Number 2 is quantifying the issue. 3 is to develop a concise statement of the issue. Or here we will learn to ask that compelling question. Number 4, determining what is known through scientific literature. Or this is finding the evidence, which includes searching the literature, appraising the evidence, and selecting the best evidence and link it with the clinician's experience and the client's values and preferences. Number 5, developing and prioritizing program and policy options. Number 6, implementing the program. And number 7, monitor the implementation of the program and evaluate the results. Now that we've learned about the 7 steps of evidence-based public health process, let's begin to apply what we have learned. The first step is to identify the problem. We want to identify the problem by describing the population, issue, and the setting. Here is an example from a community that is trying to decrease sexually transmitted diseases among the young adult population. I encourage you to pause this lesson and to find the case study on the Nursing Experts Translating the Evidence website. References for this case study can also be found on the next website. So this community has a problem with chlamydia and gonorrhea among the young adult population. Some of the assessment information that we know include Chlamydia and gonorrhea are the leading cause of infertility in the United States. As many as 33 to 50% of women infected with chlamydia and gonorrhea experience pelvic inflammatory disease. This county includes urban, suburban, and rural residents with an estimated population of 180,620 residents. The county has an active health department with an STD program and a federally qualified health center with four different offices. This county has one of the highest rates of chlamydia in the United States, and the majority of the cases are in youth and young adults. Even though gonorrhea morbidity rates are lower than those of chlamydia, they are still higher than the national county averages. After reviewing the population, the issue, and setting of the county's sexually transmitted disease problem, what outcome would you like to achieve? Well, there may be multiple outcomes. One may be to increase screening and treatment of STDs among the young adult population. Another outcome may be to increase education about safe sex practices. The second question to reflect on is, from your current knowledge base, what steps might you suggest to reach that goal? An example may be that your community assessment and professional instincts suggest that teenagers and young adults are always on their cell phones. So perhaps you would recommend reaching your goal of increasing knowledge about safe sex practices by educating teens through texting or social media. An idea. You decide to form a community coalition to address this problem, and the first step of the committee is to decide to gather more data and to quantify the issue. The second step is to quantify the issue. In this community, the committee has collected the following preliminary data. Chlamydia and gonorrhea rates are highest among individuals between the ages of 15 and 29, which is consistent with the literature from the CDC. The incidence of both chlamydia and gonorrhea within the county continue to be 1.5 to 3 times higher than that of the state and national values. The rates of both STDs are greater among African American blacks compared to their white counterparts. So please review the case study for more statistical information about STD rates, knowledge, perceived risk and behavior among young adults and the youth. In the real-world situation, you may be faced with multiple issues with multiple sources of data. If that is the situation, then you need to pull out the most important pieces that are relevant for the problem. Step number 3 of the evidence-based public health process is to develop a concise statement of the issue. Step 3 is where you will clearly state your public health issue, and we will learn to do this in a PICO format. Thank you for listening to this module about evidence-based public health. I encourage you to continue on to the next module, which is about developing a question. A focused question will help you when it's time to search the literature. Thank you.